Please welcome to the stage our panelists from the Writers Guild of America to discuss international storytelling, what it takes to make films resonate worldwide.
My name is Elizabeth Flack, and I work for the Writers Guild of America. The Writers Guild of America, we're a labor union here in the United States that has been representing writers and creative interests for more than 80 years. Our writers, who we have here today, we've planned a very good panel on international storytelling and what it takes to write and create stories that resonate worldwide. So before we get started, I just wanted to share just a little bit more about our organization. We have a collective bargaining agreement, and hiring U.S. writers here goes through the union. Our writers not only work here in the U.S. and to be creating some of the biggest movies in Hollywood that you see worldwide, but they also work on international projects in China, in France, all over the world, really. So some of our contract terms that we offer, we protect writers for financial and creative rights. We have pension and health benefits for our writers so that they can be taken care of when they're sick and when they're retired. We also have residual payments. We have credits protections for them. And we are also engaged globally in policymaking for writers and protecting interests for all writers worldwide. So if you have any questions about the Writers Guild of America and working with our writers, my coworker and I are here today. We have a booth outside. But for this panel, we're actually going to let you meet our writers and hear what they have to say about the creative writing process. So to get started, I'd like to introduce one of our most esteemed caucus members and guild members, Emily Dell. She is a writer-director. I've had the pleasure of knowing Emily for a while now. She's done a lot of great work at the Guild on behalf of her fellow members and on the Foreign Employment Task Force, which is concerned with reaching out for jobs and creating opportunities for more members worldwide. She has a new film, B-Girl, which won a Best Feature Award at the LA Femme Festival. And it can be seen on Netflix, Showtime, and Stars. Her new comic book, Romeo and Juliet and Guns, was just recently released this September. She's also directed a short action film called The Compass Rose, which also won Best Action at the Niagara Film Festival. She and her sister Emily, she's Emily, her sister Elizabeth, they have some sort of, you guys are at the museum, aren't you, in Washington, D.C.?
Yes.
You're featured there. Yeah, they're featured at the Museum for National Women's History in Washington, D.C. And she studied film at UC Berkeley and NYU, and she's also on the board of the Alliance of Women Directors. So you're in good hands with Emily, who will continue to introduce our panelists, and I really hope that you enjoy learning more about the process of writing and what it takes to make great international films. Thank you.
All right, everyone can hear me? Great. Thank you very much, Elizabeth. Yes, my name is Emily Dell. I'm a writer and film director, and I'm a member of the Writers Guild of America, very proud to be. And I am also extremely proud to be representing the Guild here for all of you today. And to be given this opportunity to bring some of the world's most successful storytellers to you. I have done some work telling stories in China myself, and the people who are here sitting next to me have made movies that were very successful in China and worldwide, and some of them have even stories about working with Chinese partners. Because we've heard a lot over the past couple of days about, deal structures and production practicalities and what it takes to put together the movies and entertainment, often on a producing side, for work between the US and China. But I really feel like the underlying theme that we've always been talking about is content. We've been talking about stories. What does it take to tell a great story that connects to hearts and minds in America, in China, and worldwide? And let me tell you, the people sitting next to me know the answer to that question. Or at least I hope you guys do. Because they have all had made many films that have been extremely beloved and successful in multiple genres worldwide. And I'm really excited for the conversation we're gonna have today, really saying, what does it take on a story level? Why? what does it take to make something that really speaks to us all as humans, over language barriers, and really connects us all. So I'm very excited to get into that. And I think we're gonna have a fascinating discussion. So you all have a few biographical details about my panelists in your packets, but I'm just gonna give you a couple more brief details. And then, unfortunately, the incredible writer sitting next to me, John Aboud, it was my fault, I didn't get the bio in time, and so you don't even have him in your booklet, so I'll start by introducing John. John and his writing partner, Michael Colton, wrote The Penguins of Madagascar for DreamWorks Animation that was released in 2014.
Yes.
And they are currently developing a feature with Oriental DreamWorks that we've heard a bit about over the past couple of days on the Chinese Zodiac. And so I'm really excited. He's kind of in the thick of the writing process, and we can talk about that as we get a little farther in. Colton and Aboud have staffed on shows such as Children's Hospital, Alan Gregory, Sit Down and Shut Up, and Leverage, and they are currently writing a feature for 20th Century Fox and a pilot for Fox Television. Then is Laeta Kalogridis, and she's a writer, producer in film and television, and her most recent film that was released on July 4th weekend, co-written with Patrick Lussier sitting to her left, is Terminator Genisys, the relaunch of the Terminator franchise for Skydance Productions. Her additional credits include the first X-Men movie, Tomb Raider, Alexander, Night Watch, and Martin Scorsese's Shutter Island, which she executive produced. And she was a producer on James Cameron's Avatar, which we all know was very popular in China. And then to Lita's left is Patrick Lussier, who's a writer as well as editor and director. So in addition to co-writing Terminator Genisys with Mitz Kalogridis, they have collaborated together since 1999. Other of his films include both Drive Angry 3D and My Bloody Valentine 3D. He directed and edited White Noise 2 and directed and co-wrote the entire Dracula vampire trilogy for Wes Craven. And he made his directorial debut with the horror fantasy The Prophecy 3. All right, so we're really lucky, and let's get into it. The first question I will start with is, the title of this panel is International Storytelling, What It Takes to Make Films Resonate Worldwide. So what do you think it takes?
I was gonna say, can I pivot to a booth?
I don't think you get to be involved in Avatar and pivot to someone else.
I really want to talk about
open
Nico
with Avatar.
Okay, all I really want to do is have a conversation about the penguin.
There'll be time for that.
Question again? What does it take? Was that the question?
Sorry, that was hard.
it's broad.
So let's start breaking it down a little bit. Let's start with character. Maybe you can think from the specifics of films, whether it's Avatar or some other ones. Let's talk about great characters that we've all connected to, and what do you think they had in common?
Actually, it's interesting. I'll take a step back from, in my head, as you're saying, I'm kind of formulating, well, things that are great international stories are usually great stories, which comes down to some combination, almost alchemical combination, mm-hmm. of character, plot, theme, visuals. You can sort of start talking in this day and age, I think, very legitimately about underlying IP, about the familiarity of certain things, especially given the success of the Marvel Universe, which we were talking about before, Terminator being literally a 30-year-old IP, created by the same person who created Avatar. Avatar is so interesting in that so much of what people came to see was classified as spectacle, but was really character. Mm-hmm. You know, I think what made the movie work as much or more than the fact that you were in an immersive 3D environment that put you in on a moon that was a world that you'd never experienced, it was completely different than Earth, was that the characters you were moving through that world with were people that you genuinely cared about and identified with. The plot itself was almost mythological in its simplicity, right? Mm-hmm. You know, I've heard people say, you know, Pocahontas, and we used to say Dances with Aliens, right? Mm-hmm. It's a very simple story. And it's because it's simple that you are able to invest in the characters the way that you can. But I guess it is just such a big question, because there are so many different things that go into making a film that people want to see over and over again, and it's hard to just pick, to just say, if you could tick off these boxes, you would have done it, right? Because if that were possible, then it would be more of a business and less of an art. And the reason it's such a collision of the two is because the artists create the things that sustain the business, but I don't think it's possible. The alliance between the two doesn't work without both. Mm-hmm. What do you need for something to succeed internationally as well? You really do need the right kind of advertising. I mean, you do. You need the right kind of platforming of your movie. You need for it to be seen at the right times in the right places. There's a whole sort of a business strategy that goes along with it, which I can't speak to at all because it's not what I do. But I know it exists. Mm-hmm. But from a character perspective, it really is, for me, as boring as saying what you want are characters that you like and identify with, who transcend culture because of the universality of what they are faced with. To me, that's what, you know, what makes any great movie work. At its core, it's always going to be that.
Mm-hmm. Well, so it's sort of also the history of stories. You know, you look at a movie like Seven Samurai, which is then remade as The Magnificent Seven, and then gets remade and remade and remade, and is being remade right now, because that's a story that just keeps going. And I'm sure there are older written versions of that story that exist long before. So it's, you know, that we're drawn to that mythology, not just of that story, but all sorts of mythologies that just keep resonating, and we keep finding them and keep reinventing them and keep reexamining them. But, you know, you look at Yojimbo, another Kurosawa film, which is then, you know, becomes the series of Man with No Name films, you know, up to The Good and the Bad and the Ugly that Clint Eastwood makes, and then becomes Last Man Standing, becomes Miller's Crossing, becomes all these other versions of the same story. Mm-hmm. That just keeps being retold across cultural and. And again, you know, like Unforgiven is made by Clint Eastwood, and then is remade by Ken Watanabe. You know, is the same film, but, you know, which is, again, speaks to, we're just drawn to that. We're drawn to those kind of characters of conflict, the characters who we identify, the characters who are damaged, characters who we identify with.
So. You could put it in terms of like big. Specific big archetypes. I mean, Mag 7 is such an interesting one because the idea of the small group of very, very talented individuals who stand up for the larger oppressed group, mm-hmm. and at great cost to themselves, and who start out by saying, no, I'm not going to do that. Oh, maybe I'm going to do it. Oh, fine, I'm totally going to do it. And the dynamics within that team, that story is told over and over and over again. And I'm actually, as you're saying it, I'm sort of antecedent-wise, I'm thinking, I wonder what the earliest recorded version of that actually is. I don't know.
Yeah,
you know,
I don't know either.
But you know there's one further back than that, because it speaks to so many different cultures. That particular myth speaks to a lot of different cultures, and it's very specifically about the protection of the innocent. Mm-hmm. Very, very specifically. And the sacrifice, sort of band of brothers sacrifice.
Well,
that comes
and,
with
it,
that.
And it's heroes who have, whose investment is very altruistic. They're not family to these people. They're not. No. They come in and they embrace the cause of the underdog and they rise up. That story is told over and over and over.
And aren't you guys partners in a company called Mythology?
Oh, actually, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I do work in a company called Mythology.
I mean, that speaks to the underlying taproot for all of this. We have the benefit and the burden of having 3,000 years of storytelling to draw upon. It's a burden in terms of you have a lot to live up to, and it's a benefit in terms of there are very few kinds of stories that have never been told before. We are reworking and reinterpreting mm-hmm. basic human desires, drives, dreams into new, relatable, accessible versions for today. And so something like The Magnificent Seven, something like the a quest, I mean, the Golden Fleece, I mean...
The Holy Grail.
The Holy Grail. Many of these stories that have been passed on to us today exist in different forms, in different cultures, mm-hmm. and always have. I mean, many of the things that we think of as fundamentally American came from ancient Greece or ancient Rome. And many of the things that you think of being uniquely French came from the steppes of Asia with tribes that, you know, brought these stories with them.
Absolutely.
No matter if it's there is this great stew of narrative out there that, you know, we just are able to pull aspects from or elements from.
So I just would love to go a little deeper with a couple of things that you've mentioned. One was the idea of a quest, an adventure quest. And I think, do you feel like Penguins of Madagascar would kind of fit in that?
Well, Penguins is in a spy movie tradition, but spy movie traditions are in with a team.
It's a team with specialized abilities. I'm sorry.
No.
Well, no.
Tell me about my movie.
Yeah.
I just really like the Penguins. That's all. I think they're very cool.
Thank you. I didn't create them. The spy movie tradition is within a hero tradition, which is within a quest tradition. So there are aspects of all of these stories and characters that are familiar to us, but reinvented for contemporary tastes, for specific references. I mean, I got to learn a lot about the origin of the penguins from the people that created them. Mike and I and another writer named Brandon, who were responsible for the feature from last year, were able to draw upon three previous movies where the penguins were side characters. And the original conception of them were the Beatles, the creators of the penguins said, we want to make a story, the story of the Beatles, but we're going to use these penguins. And then gradually over time, they kept pushing the nature of their characters in the Madagascar movie context. So like, well, what if they were like the Dirty Dozen?
Yes.
You know,
that's
what if
they start to feel like.
They start to feel like Kelly's heroes. They're scrappy, mm-hmm. and they're different. And so you can still see, though, the origin of like a group that came from nothing to success. Like that was always sort of the core of them, whether it's sort of a music group or a spy group. The underlying nature of the penguins is they have no resources. They have to make do with what they have, and that will lead them to great success. So that's sort of like their magic. And you can put them into many different contexts, but the conception, you know, stayed true to and of a very different original idea.
Mm-hmm. So we as writers often refer to archetypes and mythology and comparable stories, as we've already been doing a lot of today. And I was just thinking maybe it might be good to step back for our audience and talk about, what does that shorthand mean? What are we referencing when we talk about those kind of shorthands? Can any of you guys kind of define for the audience?
It means a classical education is terribly valuable, and you continue reading. And I just actually started reading the Poetic Vedas the other night, mm-hmm. because I was thinking, here's the further back you go, the more commonality there are in different myths, and the sort of the idea that because we're separated by our languages and separated by geography, that the stories that we tell are radically different, just isn't true. I was actually rereading a translation of Gilgamesh, which is a very universal quest story. Yeah. And it seems...
It's the first romance.
And it is. It absolutely is. It's this intense relationship between these two friends that kind of transcends even
death. Yeah.
Love and death, yeah. even the woman that he's in love with. And it's really interesting to me, the answer to that question is it's not definable in the sense, again, that you could quantify something and say it has to tick this box, this box, this box. But the more you have read and experienced of literary traditions that come from different places, and a lot of them are, which is kind of funny, they're originally spoken traditions, right? Mm-hmm. Because if you think about it, we're not, I don't know, I think you've said this to me before, when you're watching a movie, it is not dissimilar from sitting around a fire listening to people tell
Absolutely.
A story.
Absolutely, yeah. It's essentially a big sort of projected ghost story. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. you're telling the story of the past, you're telling the story of events, and so much of it comes from just the love of stories, all stories. You know,
yeah.
how the stories you knew as a kid, the ones that drew you as a kid, you sort of keep being drawn to your whole life. whatever it is. You find the themes of them. You find the themes of the sort of absolutely horrific nature of the stories in the Brothers Grimm or Beatrix Potter.
And Ulysses was, theoretically anyway, what's attributed to him wasn't written by him. Mm-hmm. He was part of an oral tradition. So I think the further back you go and the more you absorb and read as much as you can of earlier mythological traditions, the more you're able to see what the commonalities are, what we've taken forward into our culture, how it's shaped our culture. But it's a very intangible thing, right? Yeah. It's as intangible as what makes a movie work.
Yeah, absolutely, because that's such a collision of different forces, of different creative inputs. I think a lot of the challenge of international filmmaking, you mentioned the Zodiac project that we were working on for Oriental Dreams. We're actually done with that now. It's in development. There's another feature that's going to be coming out before that. It's called Everest. It's been publicly announced. I don't think there's any secret there. Mm-hmm. But on the Zodiac project, so much of it was finding the underlying mythology that could apply to any culture in the world, but that was conceived of as a China first release. Mm-hmm. So there was a lot of work that had to be done on our part to understand the specific context in which the Chinese audience sees the Zodiac and what that means to them. It's very different than what a Western audience thinks about the Zodiac. When we first saw what they had in the development process, the movie opened with images of stars and constellations, and the main character talked about changing her destiny or changing her stars. And what we learned Mike and I thankfully knew going in, and we had to be those nerdy guys who said, isn't the Chinese Zodiac about the calendar and not constellations? Like, no, it won't matter, that won't matter, that'll be fine. And we had our Chinese partners and consultants come in and they said, like, you guys know that the Zodiac's based on the calendar, right? It's like, all right, we'll change it. So like there are Western, not biases, but Western assumptions that you can come in with that you quickly have to educate yourself around. The main character talked about changing her destiny, but according to our collaborators on the Chinese, in the Shanghai office of Oriental DreamWorks and some of the consultants that were brought in, it is a much more common idea in China to think about changing your fortune. Destiny is fixed. So what is going to happen to the character's life has been predetermined, but she has the power to make of it what she can. She has the power to perceive it a certain way. She has the power to influence how she's perceived by others and how she deals with the hand that has been dealt her. And that was a fascinating, way to reconceive of the plotline in the story and alter the character to be universal but readily accessible to the Chinese audience, which is the primary intended target audience.
So this is a perfect segue talking about how we kind of resonate with ancient stories, but we also bring them into the modern era and localize them or make them, or try to make them authentic for a specific audience base. And John, you told me a really funny story about the ox character that I was hoping you could share and how you localized that.
Well, Mike and I heard a joke from someone who worked in the Shanghai office that they said, some of you may have heard this may be an old hoary joke at this point now, but they said a modern businessman is walking down the street in Shanghai and he reaches out to wave to a friend and a car driving down the street takes his arm right off and he says, oh no, my Rolex. So that is an archetype that is very common now apparently in Shanghai and Beijing. And so one of the characters in the Zodiac, the ox, was conceived of as a shopaholic who is draped in luxury brands at all times, is sort of staggering under the weight of her Prada bags and had shopping bags dangling from her horns. And that is something that was going to, be recognizable to the Chinese audience, to the American audience. They said, well, what's the access point for the American audience? They modeled the character to look like Meghan Trainor, who was, you know, very big, you know, at that time. Her video had just come out. And so down to like the hairstyle, and they modeled her walk on Meghan Trainor. So it was something where you had a comedy aspect to the Chinese audience that was very specific. You had a comedy aspect to the American audience that was very specific. And it was the process of finding areas of overlap, things that worked in both contexts and wouldn't stand out necessarily as being discordant in either venue. Yeah.
So, Laeta and Patrick, maybe you don't localize as specifically to your audiences, but what you do is you kind of go otherworldly. You make things even bigger, and maybe that helps us all connect to them without a specific, like, do you have a sense of trying to make a bigger world when you sit down to write, or a visual world?
Certainly a visual world, I think. I think in terms of, you know, Terminator, when we were doing that, one of our ways into the story, being huge fans of the original James Cameron's first two films, was wanting to, A, make it very Arnold specific, you know, especially, you know, he being the big iconic image of the series, you know, and also to write for his age, so figure out a story that would make him age appropriate. We like the idea of an older hero, and the redemption that goes involved with that, and then also to have a nostalgic factor of, I think one of the first things we talked about was creating a callback to the whole 1984 sequence in that movie, where we recreated something that had become iconic the world over as an entry point, certainly as an entry point for us in the creation of it, and then it exploded out and branched out from that. And then within it, the character relationships and focusing on sort of the very unique father-daughter relationship of that story, which ground the heart of the film, the heart of the story, that was key. And then other stuff just sort of expands and contracts based on what the story wants and what the budget requires.
And you can look at it a little bit in terms of answering the question is kind of like reverse engineering, in the sense of you look at how well it did in China and you ask yourself, okay, well, where were the overlaps culturally, storytelling-wise, that made such a difference? And I actually think, of course, there's the nostalgia factor. Of course, there's the tremendous power of the IP, which is huge. Mm-hmm. There's also something very universal about the family dynamic that's created within it. There's something very universal about the strong father who has a specific opinion. In this case, it really is. She has a destiny, and there isn't a choice about it, right. And she's fighting against it. And the person who shows up to marry her is more or less an arranged marriage, and it's not the marriage that she wants, but she doesn't have a choice about it. I actually think that those kinds of family dynamics are very much cross-cultural and certainly played very well for the Chinese audience, at least the numbers seem to indicate. And I like to think that part of it was the universality of just the family story, just that little tiny family story of the arranged marriage and the boyfriend who doesn't really like the father and the father who doesn't really like the boyfriend. And
yeah, because that's the thing I think everybody can identify with, and the trappings that go along with, you know, a big sort of time travel battle story.
Yeah.
That can work or not work. Really, what matters is what's the heart of the story. Mm-hmm. And the heart of the story is that family dynamic, and that's what people latch on to. Everything else is the trappings that give you the roller coaster ride. But you care about the roller coaster ride because of the characters and because of their interaction.
I think sci-fi, fantasy, action, all benefit you in terms of giving you tools to play with to create an interesting dilemma. If the interesting dilemma at the heart of your story is accessible and relatable and interesting, then, you know, really that is the hook that will keep people coming back and will make your story compelling. Back to the Future, you know, is a comedy essentially, but it is a wonderful science fiction story because it presents a dilemma. Mm-hmm. What if I saw my parents before me? What would I do in that situation? How would I, you know, see what they came from in the context of I know what they became. Mm-hmm. And how do I make sure that I don't disappear by, you know, making sure that they get together, even though I now know how many obstacles there were to that ever happening. Mm-hmm. The you know, to look at Terminator Genisys and see the family story in there is to really see the underlying hook, is to see mm-hmm. the underlying dilemma that the characters are going through. The trappings of Star Wars and the Force and what that means, you know, are less important than it's the story of a farmer who wants to be where the action is. Mm-hmm. You know, those kinds of underlying dilemmas are what become the access point to any kind of mythology, no matter how, and I mean that in the sort of modern filmmaking sense, no matter how complicated they may be.
Mm-hmm. But that is a very, the simplest possible story that I think you look at as being very cross-cultural is a kid who comes from the sticks somewhere who very much wants to be part of a larger world and doesn't know how to get from here to there, but has a destiny to do it and yeah. a talent to do it. And then the story of how that happens and how that particular person moves from one environment to another, that maybe it's because we all have cities and we all have small towns and we yeah. all have, you know, agricultural areas and we all have more urban areas. And, you know, if you remember, what he really wanted to do was go to the academy
yeah.
and essentially be in the military.
Yeah.
You know, he really aspired to be in the military. I don't know. I think there's so much more commonalities to family stories and personal stories yeah. than there are differences.
Yeah. I'm really glad that you brought up family, and Patrick, you mentioned heart. So is it that we're really trying to tap into a deep emotional connection?
I think so. I think that's the thing that, you know, you so much when you're writing, you put pieces of yourself in it, and I think a lot of that happens because you write variations of your own sort of emotional dynamics, whatever that is, you know, whatever you've gone through, that all paints across what you're doing, whether you know it or not. It does. Mm-hmm. You know, I was very lucky to have edited for Wes Craven for a number of years. He would always talk about stories. All his stories had real strong family dynamic. They were all, and the family was, there was always sort of a corruption in the family. There was always something mm-hmm. sort of oppressive about it. And a lot of that speaks to how Wes grew up and what his background was. And mm-hmm. he was, you know, even up to Freddy Krueger, he was, you know, all those things, he was exercising his own, the view of the world that he had as a child growing up in a very religious household, and how that had changed, and then how, you know, coming up through the late 60s and early 70s, how that, when his mind opened up, how things really changed for him. But it all came back to how he started, and that's why so many of his stories have that emotional core and have sort of dysfunctional families in them, and different things that that are so recognizable for everybody who watches them. Mm-hmm. I think it just goes part and parcel with that. You know, you try and, okay, what's the heartbeat of the story? What's the pulse that you identify with? You know, what do people want? What do they need? What do they, what will they die for? What will they kill for? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And often a challenge in the practical movie making aspect of all of this is that audiences don't necessarily know why they like something. Mm. They don't necessarily talk about
right.
the
Very
family
true.
Dynamic. They might talk about that battle scene, mm. you know, or that yeah. particular effect, or that trailer moment, that sequence. Mm. The thing that's working on them on a subconscious level is what the writer ideally has to be the guardian of mm-hmm. and the protector of, and has to sort of preserve that underlying architecture that the audience isn't even conscious of. And when we talk to our executives, mm-hmm. when we talk to our, you know, producers on the studio side, they need to know that there's going to be the trailer moment. They need to know that there's going to be something that they can sell that is going to create buzz. It's going to be the mm-hmm. spectacular stunt or set piece. So you have a responsibility to craft as many of those and as big and as interesting mm-hmm. of those as you can, but you can't neglect the underlying architecture of the story, because that is so fundamental to why it will connect.
So maybe we're developing a framework here, and correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems like we're kind of starting from the big stories that are worldwide, this mythology as our, like the human ancient stories, and then we build onto that family and emotion. And so I'm glad that you mentioned, because my next question is, when do we bring in the monsters and the aliens and the cool gadgets that the penguins play with?
Monsters seem to be, interestingly, in some ways, they're a little bit culturally specific, and in some ways they're not. You know, there are some monsters you look at and say, oh, this particular thing comes from our fear of technology. This particular thing comes from our fear of nuclear annihilation. This particular thing comes from our fear of nuclear mutation. I'm thinking of, the traditional, Godzilla and the giant big
But it's almost
mantra.
Like if there's two basic emotions, sort of love and fear, right? Mm-hmm. So you either will do something for love or do something because you're absolutely, you know, terrified of it. And the monster comes out of that. The monster comes out of the dark. From the earliest time you were afraid of the dark. From the earliest time, it's the thing you don't know, the thing that's unseen. It's the alien is another word for just something unknown, right? Something that you don't know, that and really is that part of yourself. Is that so much of that battle is am I the monster? Am I the person who loves, or am I the person who's afraid? Well, we're all both. We all go through life as both. So that's where I think you tap into the things that give people a catharsis to experience that part of themselves by scaring the shit out of them, or making them sit on the edge of the seat because they're afraid their planet's mm-hmm. going to get blown up, or whatever that is, because they get to, through stories, whether it's books or campfire stories or movies or whatever, they get to experience the visceral nature of facing the part of themselves that, and largely are not, may not feel safe for them to face any other way, mm-hmm. or they may not even know how to. But you can face it through a story, and the reason you identify with it is because you're seeing a piece of yourself there.
And then you survive it.
And then
story
you survive
allows
it.
You to survive
the
it.
Story, you get off the roller coaster and you go, woo, let's go again.
Theoretically, you can figure out something from the story that allows you to survive in real life better. But yeah, that's monsters do all come from what's inside us. Absolutely true.
Yeah, those rules don't just apply to Godzilla. Shakespeare is full of stories of leaders who thought they inspired love, only to discover that they are really ruling through fear.
Yes.
And dealing, and they are confronting the monster within. So we can externalize those emotions through King Kong, through the Transformers, what have you. But ultimately, they are expressions of relatable journeys that, you know, an adolescent has to go through, that an adult has to go through, someone retiring has to go through, these different stages of life.
So I'm going to open it up for questions in a moment. I'm going to ask the panelists one more question and we'll discuss, but if you guys have anything you would like to ask, you can kind of start making your way to any of the microphones. And so we've talked a lot about the theory and the underlying elements of these great stories, but then there's always a sense of fun, right? So I would love you guys to close by, and if nobody asks any questions, we'll just keep talking. Close by telling us, maybe sharing some real fun time you had at the movies recently, and why you think you had so much fun.
Fun is always at someone else's movie, because you didn't work on it, so you don't have to think about everything that went into making it. So I don't know, what's the most fun of the last however many months? I keep coming.
It could even be something you saw last week.
Well, no, because all of my favorites are actually probably a little further back. I loved The Machine. You know, that was incredibly fun. Mm-hmm. Amazingly good imagination of what the first intelligent thinking machine might be like. Mm-hmm. A lot of crossover with Terminator, but you know, I didn't have to do it, so so I like it better. To watch, just to enjoy. I really, really liked Snowpiercer. You know I love Snowpiercer so much.
Yeah. I mean,
that's monsters in ourselves.
Because that's a great fun movie when it gets to the end.
I was just saying, it's like I really love Guardians of the Galaxy. Does that count?
Yeah.
No, but it follows a fun movie. There's a smaller movie that was a great throwback to those kind of horror movies you saw, you know, as a teenager and things like that, and somebody who really captured that vibe again, and you know, made it for 78 cents and a pack of gum, and you just, it was, you can go see, you know, Mad Max Fury Road, and it's great, you know, has a wonderful nostalgia factor,
and it's
full of rampant badassery, and then you go see something smaller and more intimate, and admire the sheer will that it took somebody to make it.
Yeah.
And how they captured a feeling that you had when you were younger, when you saw something, and it's like, oh my God, that's exactly what that felt like. That's exactly what that sounded like. That feeling of dread was so familiar, and it was great that somebody could reproduce that.
I think Fury Road is the first movie in a long, long time that I've been tempted to walk out, buy another ticket, and walk right back in. That just is something that I, you know, had no shame doing growing up, and haven't really been tempted to do even, you know, recently. But it felt like it pushed all of my buttons,
yeah,
you know, in exactly the right way. But it was so contemporary. It was so, by having, you know, really, the title is so misleading. It's not Mad Max's movie.
Not at all.
It's her movie. And, you know, it was just reinventing a kind of sensation for a contemporary audience that I thought was spectacular.
It's such broke every rule. And that's like, if you're actually talking about, okay, here are the rules. Well, rule number one, it supposedly, is you're not supposed to make R-rated action films because they won't do as well internationally. Clearly, that was not the case with this film. It did hugely well internationally. It's supposed to have a male lead.
Yeah.
It isn't even really a two-hander.
No.
I mean, it's Furiosa's movie, like hands down, so to speak. Since she's missing
one.
It doesn't have a even remotely a happy ending. Not even remotely.
No.
I mean, it could be worse. They could all be dead. but still, you are talking about at one point a woman who gets run over, who's pregnant, and somebody holding up like the dead corpse. I mean, it's. Everything that you're not supposed to do to make a successful film domestically and internationally, this film did. Mm-hmm. And it completely succeeded, which to me just says that mythological underpinning, which we are all very familiar with, that the warrior goddess myth, that's what she is.
Also a quest for freedom.
Yes.
Quest for freedom, and it's also a version of Outlaw Josie Wales.
Absolutely.
Right? You have a warrior who gathers around people who they begrudgingly end up forming this family, and you know,
can't really fight.
It's very much that same story.
Yeah.
I have a question.
Yes, please.
Hi, Eric Marinho. I'm with the Los Angeles Brazilian Film Festival. I'm a member. I also am a producer and actor. And I have a project called Vanity of the Seas. And it's a romance supernatural story. So how is the supernatural today embraces the large audience, like ghost and, you know, that aspect of filmmaking, you know? Because it's so fascinating to see you guys talking about all the levels of the formatting of how to write and what to sell and the elements that make sense to the audience and the people, mostly with the family and the heart and the care. And a romance is translated into depth of a person that lost someone, and then it's reunited in the afterlife.
Mm-hmm.
So that arena, you know what I mean, that I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm. I think, you know, supernaturally, I think everybody's afraid to die. Everybody wonders what happens after you do, you know.
Everyone's afraid to lose someone.
And what that means, and you know, so often in life, places aren't haunted, people are, right? I'm stealing that. That's not original. but the idea that you know, we're all haunted by the things we didn't do, the people we lost, the people we didn't connect with who we should have, the people who we let slip through our fingers. And I think that's why those supernatural stories resonate, is that they're all so much about feelings of loss and regret and how to, and often they're a chance to get it back. Often they're a chance to reface it. Often whether it be facing it through fear or facing it through being reunited with a loved one and whatever that is.
The level of grief, sometimes it doesn't sell as much for an audience. They don't appreciate to have someone going through a process of grief that's too intense. And there is a level to show that within the depth of the character towards, like, I never see like a guy that's in grief, but his grief is not too sad, but romantic, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. towards the loved one that he lost. And then...
Well, that raises an interesting thing, I think, in terms of a specifically American context, is because Americans believe in pulling yourself up by your yeah. bootstraps. They don't like to see loss. They don't like to yeah. see grief. Mm-hmm. Why don't get over it? Mm-hmm. Move on.
Yes.
And a ghost story is great in an American context because you don't have the option necessarily of moving on, of getting over something. It is a sort of literal representation of the past. They won't yep. go away. Yep. So, you know, I think I've seen, you know, I'm trying to think of other, I mean, Spirited Away is a great movie about, you know, dealing with the other world beyond mm-hmm. that is a much more sort of, you know, it's very frightening at times, it's yeah. very lush and romantic at times in terms mm-hmm. of, you know, escaping into a fantasy world. Other cultures have various tolerances yeah. you know, for how much we deal with grief, and that's expressed in the way they deal with ghosts. Mm-hmm. There's an Eastern concept of the hungry ghost, yeah. which lingers, you know, that's not a concept that's as prominent in the West. So we yeah. all express our unique ways of dealing with the past and the legacy of the past.
Sure.
Did you ever see, sorry, I know we need to move to the next question, but this is really, yeah. really, did you ever see the Chinese movie, early 90s, maybe, a Ghost Detective?
I haven't yeah. seen Ghost Detective, yeah. no.
One of the things I love about that movie is, have you seen it? Mm. It is the way it reflects at least a little bit in the idea of ghosts being all around you. In Chinese society, you're in that movie. Mm-hmm. I'm not from China, but obviously. But
the rules of that movie.
The rules yeah. of that movie are that so much about the constant presence of ghosts everywhere, and your main character is a policeman who can see them, and whose partner is a ghost, even though no one can see his partner, and whose girlfriend is someone in a coma, mm-hmm. because she's straddling the two worlds. And his interactions with all of these ghosts, I mean, the very first scene is him burning a card. There's a schoolgirl on top of a building. He burns a card, and it shows up in her hand, because that's how you give things mm. to the dead, you burn them. And he tells her she's died. And it's the matter of factness about the presence of the lost,
yeah.
Which is so different than how I feel our films deal with loss.
Oh, for sure.
It's yeah. really, really interesting. I love that movie. It's yeah. a great movie.
I'm going to check that out.
Oh, now. It's yeah. really good. I mean, you've seen it. It's great.
Yeah.
Hi. You talked a lot about the commonality of different cultures. What are the differences? What are the holes to avoid?
I think you have to come in with a lot of humility and a lot of willingness to learn. You have to. I mean, I took the Zodiac Project as a real opportunity to, you know, deep dive into what is contemporary life like in China now, and what are the underlying stories that still resonate. I took the chance to sort of check out the Three Kingdoms, the Saga of the Three Kingdoms from the library, because I had heard that that is something that even, you know, today is sort of the epic poem of, you know, Middle Ages China, and learn a lot about the contemporary struggle between, you know, a consumption society and a society that saves and is almost pessimistic in terms of, you know, when will the next, you know, catastrophe, disaster strike? And there are ways to try to incorporate all of those aspects into the story of someone journeying from the country to the city. Our lead character was a cat who, you know, had known her whole life. You're not part of the Zodiac. You don't get to be a part of the Zodiac. Well, why can't I be part of the Zodiac? And she journeys to Shanghai and gets on a reality show that's rerunning the race of the Zodiac, the ancient mythology that underlies the Zodiac. So it's a matter of sort of combining the two, but being open to realizing how little you know about this going in and being willing to synthesize and learn.
Thank you. I think my answer would be so boring too, because humility is really, really, really super key. Travel is also incredibly key, which none of us, I think, get to do as much as we would like outside of work, because you can't experience a culture when you're
in a bubble.
In a bubble with other English speakers trying to make something, trying to make filmed entertainment. But I do always find it fascinating to look at just the exposure that George Lucas had to the samurai in film is what created the Jedi Knights. I mean, that is thought of as the super Western movie, the Star Wars movies, but they are so deeply informed by an entirely different filmic tradition that the very least we can do is read as much as we can read and watch as much as we
watch
can
as watch. Much, yeah, watch yeah, as many Chinese absolutely. Movies
yeah.
as we can.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Aina and I'm from China. So my question is kind of opposed to our topic. It's about how could Chinese story travel through the world. For example, now we have more and more movie about based on Chinese mythology. Mm-hmm. Like we have 1,000 years of culture and mythology. So for your opinion, how does fairy tales appealing to you, and if we want to sell it to American market, how could we adapt them to the audience? Thank you.
How do you adapt them to the audience? I think so often it is good stories that find the audience. I remember
Heroic Trio. I'm just like literally
well,
in my
Heroic
head,
Trio, Bride with White Hair, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. When I was directing a movie called Dracula 2,000 years ago, I was a huge fan of Bride with White Hair, which was shot by a Chinese cinematographer named Peter Pao, who won the Oscar for Crouching Tiger. And I somehow conned somebody into giving me his phone number in Hong Kong and called him, and it turned out in the middle of the night in Hong Kong, because I didn't bother to think about the time difference, and he answered in Chinese, and I just started speaking English, and he sort of spoke English, and a week later, hired him and met him in Toronto, and we had this amazing relationship. But I think I was always such a fan of, Chinese ghost story, the Choi Hark movies and things that he produced, and became really drawn to the culture of those movies, and see how elements of those movies became more and more apparent in Western movies, The Matrix, how that derives so much the visual style from the Chinese.
The Matrix is a Hong Kong film. It really is. You just look at everything about that story, about the destiny, about what, even the things that are said to him by Morpheus are largely taken from a combination of different Chinese philosophers. None of that is Western thinking, about walking the path and opening the door yourself and looking for salvation within yourself. I mean, not that I meant to cut you off, because
no,
I
just
about
think
Peter
it's already
Powell
happening.
Day, but
I think it's already there.
Yes.
That influence is so strong and apparent. How does it become more so? I think it becomes more so making stories that are more internationally based, stories with characters that are international casts, where you see people, characters from China, Chinese characters in Western type stories, and vice versa, where everything begins to cross pollinate.
The more you mingle the people, the more the people who create the stories mingle the stories. Mm-hmm. And that's the, well, things like this are the key. But all that mythology, and this is the horrible and beautiful thing about movies as a business, that mythology is amazing. That mythology is wonderful. That mythology will sell tickets. And therefore, sooner or later, people will start recognizing, people who write checks to make movies will start recognizing, I can make a profit off of this. That really, what will drive it is interaction between people and that cross-pollination that creates stories that then start making money.
Because these ancient Chinese stories that are the exact same rooted human fundamental stories that we began this conversation on, these epic journeys.
We feel
absolutely.
It in our gut.
We all feel it
all
in
of
here.
Us audience members, we feel the universality of it. Even though the trappings may be slightly different, mm-hmm. We all feel the same kind of emotions about those stories.
I think so much of it is casting. You know,
it's
in terms of
casting and language too.
It's casting and language and sort of having, you know, aspects that appeal to both, you know, familiar faces, celebrities, stars, people with real magnetism. I mean, because there will always be core fan groups that are hungry for the material in its original form. Expanding beyond that, I think, is all about casting. I mean, people, I mean, all the antecedents of the Matrix films, you know, yeah. I always want to say sweetheart, but like Troy Hart, you know, it's sort of like, yeah. those there's always like a platform to build off of. You, Chow Yun-Fat became, you know, for a brief moment, yeah. you know, a big draw among American audiences because there's just an undeniable level of magnetism to a star, no matter what country you're from. A star is a star, and stars, you know, translate and travel.
And there is a reality to the fact that most, and this is just flatly true, an awful lot of movies now make more than two-thirds of their overall take from overseas grosses, of which, you know, the Chinese piece is disproportionately large. Yeah. So that will drive market. It just
for sure.
will.
I think maybe we have
Thank
time
you.
For
Welcome.
Two more questions. Thank you.
Hi, thank you for sharing all your thoughts and the openness to these questions. My name is Jan. I'm from China, and I did my MFA in film production here in LA. My partner and I represent an equivalent organization, nonprofit organization, as WGA, called Screenwriters Guild of China. To negotiate collaboration with WGA last year. And so here's my question. Recently, I listened to the writer's broadcast script notes. Mm-hmm. So I heard Craig Mazin said it's the first time in the history that Hollywood in the pre-production need to think about Chinese audience. It's not only about American audience. Yeah. So to me, it's very fascinating. So he has some concern, right? So I want to ask all of you your personal opinion that collaborating with China, it could be very exciting, but also could be scary because you must have a lot of concern because it's a totally new world. So I want to ask about your concern. The reason I ask is because as a Chinese producer, we also want to really help the collaboration. So that's why I asked the question. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I perhaps somewhat naively, I mean, there's lots of things you can talk about that are concerns. Physical production is nothing but one long headache of concerns. I find it nothing but exciting that the economics support all of us becoming more world storytellers. I think that's tremendous. It makes me happy. It's also, as I said, an excuse to travel, and that is always a good thing. Mm-hmm. So, there's nothing about it that I don't like. Really.
No, totally agree. I think it's a great way to expand storytelling, expand the settings and locales and mythology that you get to tap into.
It's really a wonderful time to be a filmmaker to kind of see that broadening out.
Yeah, I think that I heard that same podcast, and there's sort of, you know, two buckets. There's the artistic concern, there's the economic, financial concern. On an artistic level, it seems nothing but good. Yeah. I mean, it seems like such an opportunity to broaden the voices that tell stories, to broaden the pool of voices geographically, ethnically, culturally that are, you know, having access to a global audience. On the financial level, I think a lot of what Craig was concerned about was just sort of transparency. And, you know, how do we create new structures? Because we are dealing with the, you know, challenges of just logistics, you know, just how to make sure that the, you know, all the receipts are counted. And in the States and in the West, there is a long tradition of, you know, lawyers chasing down money because our own, you know, the studios themselves.
I wasn't going to go there. I wasn't even going to mention regiments, but yeah, you know, apparently he's going to mention it.
Yeah,
so yes.
I mean, no, the studios have had such a, the American studios have had such a, you know, combative history with,
yes.
you know, the creators that there's a whole regime in place to track down money and, you know, in other markets.
There is a structure in place that may not necessarily exist.
Yeah, in I know it's more of an issue in South America, in parts of Asia. You know, India has a very robust film market. They have those structures in place.
I have to apologize. They're telling us we have to wrap up because I think a lot of hungry people want to get to lunch. Okay. But anyone who has other
we'll
questions,
after.
Please
we'll
come and
after,
find us afterwards. Please help me thanking our panelists today. Gave us a little window into telling some great stories worldwide. So thank you very much to everyone for having us.